In this module, we will learn about forces. Force is something that causes a change in the velocity of an object. In other words, force is what causes an acceleration. Forces are vectors and they have the units of Newton. A Newton is equal to kg meter per second square. Typically, when there are multiple forces acting on an object, we need to add them vectorially. To find the total force, we just add the individual forces treated as vectors. And this is called the resultant force or the unbalanced force. Typically, when we are dealing with problems, we are interested in this net force. And there is a famous equation called Newton's second law, which we will cover in a later module. This equation gives us an explicit expression for force. It's F equals ma, force equals mass times acceleration. So let us go through this example of adding forces in one dimension. So you can see here, there is a 2 Newton force pulling this object towards the left, and an 8 Newton force pulling this object towards the right. So what is the net force? So you just use vector addition in one dimension, and the net force is 8 minus 2 newtons, 6 newton acting horizontally to the right. And then let us take a look at a 2D example. So there is a 3 newton force acting horizontally on this object, and a 5 newton force acting at 45 degrees to the horizon. And then there's a 2 Newton force acting at 30 degrees below the horizon. So to deal with this problem, you have to decompose each of the forces into their x and y components. And you can do this because you know the angle the forces are making with the horizontal axis. And if you decompose the 5 Newton force, you get components such as this, 5 Newton sine 45 degree, minus 5 Newton sine 45 degree for the y component, minus 5 Newton cos 45 degree for the x component. Similarly, you can decompose the 2 Newton force into the x and y components. And then you just add all the x components of the three forces and the y components of the three forces, and you get the net force or the resultant force. This brings us to the definition of equilibrium. When the sum of all the forces acting on an object is zero, we say the object is in equilibrium. And this also applies to each of the individual components. For an object to be in equilibrium, the sum of all the forces along each of the components, x and y, has to be independently zero. So there are typically two classes of forces, contact forces and field forces. Contact forces simply mean that there has to be some physical contact between an object and the source of the force, applied force. For example, if you push or pull an object, you are physically applying the force on the object. Or if you attach an object to a spring and pull it, so the spring is physically exerting a force on the object. Field forces are a bit different. Examples of field forces are gravitational fields or electric fields, for example, or magnetic fields. And they don't need physical contacts, basically. So for example, if I drop this object in the air, it falls without any physical contact, right? Because the earth is pulling this object towards itself, but the earth is not physically touching this object, basically. So this is an example of a field force. So what is the force that the earth applies on a body that is freely falling, such as this, right? So this is the famous example of the apple falling from the tree that inspired Newton to come up with his famous laws of motion. And gravity. So this is this is given by F equals mg. This also comes from F equals ma, the same equation, Newton's second law. But m here is the mass of the object, and g is the acceleration due to gravity, which assumes a value of 9.8 meter per second square close to the surface of the Earth. We also need to distinguish between mass and weight. Too often we use these terms interchangeably, but there's a difference actually. So mass is a scalar quantity, whereas weight is a vector quantity. Weight is actually a force, basically. So when you are weight is the weight is equal to actually the force of gravity, which is equal to mg, as we just saw. So you need to multiply mass by the acceleration due to gravity in order to obtain a weight, and this is a vector quantity as opposed to the mass, which is a scalar quantity. So let us look at some examples of contact forces. So first let us look at a normal force. So normal force is a force that is perpendicular to the surface of an object, basically. So for example, if I am resting this object on my hand, so this object has a weight, so because the earth is pulling it down, but to keep it stationary, my hand is also exerting a force upward to counteract that gravitational pull. So if you are resting a book on a table, the book pushes on the table due to its weight, but the table also pushes on the book upward to keep it balanced on the table, otherwise it would move, right, with an acceleration. So this vertical force that the table is exerting on the book, that is the normal force. The vertical force my hand is exerting on this object, that is the normal force. Now let us look at another type of contact force. It's called tension. So if you attach a rope to an object and pull the rope, so the rope becomes taut and there is a tension in the rope. So this is labeled as T. So also an example is a pulley with two masses, for example. So there is a tension force acting in the rope. Free body diagrams. These are simplified force diagrams that are very useful to solve problems. For example, let us look at the problem that we just described, a book resting on a table, and draw the free body diagram for this. The rule for drawing a free body diagram is the following. Consider first one object at a time. For example, if we are drawing the free body diagram of this block, then we need to draw this block as a dot or a box, for example, and draw all the forces that are just acting on that block alone, basically. There is some other force in the system, but not acting on this object, some other object, we don't draw that force. Only we consider the forces that are acting on this block. So the two forces that are acting on this block are the normal force of the table and the weight of the block acting downwards, that is given by the gravitational pull of the Earth. So the free body diagram just looks like this. Fn pointing upward along the y-axis, the normal force, and Fg, the gravitational pull, pointing downward along the y-axis. And these two forces are balancing each other. That's why the block is not moving vertically, not accelerating vertically. It's at rest on the table. And when we are drawing free body diagrams, we are typically, for this course, we are ignoring, we are making some approximations. So we are ignoring masses of ropes and pulleys, all these objects. Now let us look at the tension force. So if we attach a rope to an object and pull it, so there's a tension force, because when you are pulling the object, you feel a resistance. So the weight of the block is kind of resisting you to pull, and that pull you can feel through the rope. So there's a tension force acting on your hand in the other way, resisting your pull. There's a tension force also acting on the object, basically, because of your pull. So now let us draw all the forces that are acting on the object. So there is the normal force, the surface on which the object rests. That surface is applying a normal force to the object. And there is the gravitational pull, the weight of the force acting downward. But because of your pull, there is a tension force also pulling the block to the right. And so this is shown in this figure. So there are three forces acting on the block alone. Notice that we don't draw the tension force acting on the hand because we are just drawing the free body diagram of the block. So now let us look at another type of contact force, the frictional force. frictional force usually causes a resistance to motion. So if an object is moving along one direction, a frictional force acts in the opposite direction to resist the motion. And so there are two types of frictional forces, static frictional forces and kinetic frictional forces. And let me begin by explaining static force, the static frictional force. So consider a block, a block resting on a surface that is stationary, right? So if we draw the free body diagram of this block, there are two forces acting, a normal force perpendicular to the surface and the weight of the block acting vertically downward, right? So there are no forces, I haven't applied any other forces to the system, and the object is stationary. Now I apply a force and try to pull the object to the left, and this I apply a very small force, and I see that the object is object does not move, right? So technically I have applied a force, so it should accelerate, but it's not. That means there is another force in the system acting in the opposite direction to balance the applied force, and that is the force of static friction. Now if I increase the applied force a little bit, then I find the block is still not moving, so the frictional force must have also increased in magnitude to counteract the applied force, the increase in the applied force. So now I applied a lot of force, and at some point the object begins to move, right? So I have counteracted the frictional force, the static frictional force. So there must be a maximum static frictional force that I had to overcome to move the block, basically. And the maximum static frictional force is given by the product of a coefficient called mu s and the normal force n, basically. The larger the normal force, the higher is this force of static friction, because I mean the object is pressing harder against the surface, basically. So it is harder to move. What is this mu s coefficient? So it's called the coefficient of static friction. It's a property of the surface and the contact region between the object, between the two objects. So if the surface is rough, this coefficient is larger. If the surface is smooth, such as ice, this coefficient is smaller. So this coefficient just gives you an idea of how easy it is to move the object, or what is the maximum frictional force that you have to overcome. So notice the inequality. Fs, the frictional force, is less than mu s times n, the normal force. So the mu s times n is the maximum static frictional force you have to overcome to set the object in motion. Then the other type of frictional force is called the kinetic friction. So this is given by another coefficient, mu k. This is called the coefficient of kinetic friction, and then the product with the normal force n. So the higher the normal force, the larger is the force of kinetic friction. And mu k parameter, the coefficient of kinetic friction, it is different from mu s, the coefficient of static friction. It's again, but mu k is again a property of the surface and the contact region between the two objects, basically. So if mu k is smaller, it is easier for the object to slide. If it is bigger, it is difficult, basically. You have to overcome. To keep the object in motion, you have to apply a larger force. So let us go through this worked example. So a box is placed on the back of a truck and the truck accelerates away. The coefficient of friction between the surface of the truck and the box is mu. Draw a free body diagram to identify all forces acting. So this is kind of the same problem that we have described. And if we draw the free body diagram, we have the weight of the block acting vertically downward, the normal force from the surface of the truck to the block acting upward, force the truck is exerting on the block, that's acting towards the left, for example, and the frictional force opposing that, this is the force of static friction because the object is stationary. So the frictional force is acting opposite to that applied force, the force applied by the truck. What is the direction of acceleration of the box? So the box initially is moving with the truck because the applied force does not overcome the static frictional force. The block is stationary in the truck, basically. So the block is moving along the direction of the truck, with the truck, but it is at rest in the frame, in the reference frame of the truck. what is the direction of the net force acting on the box? What is the direction of the acceleration? The acceleration is also in the same direction as the truck. It is the truck's acceleration. Under what conditions would the box move, would the box not move with the truck? So when you overcome the maximum static frictional forces, then the block can slide. The block will not remain stationary on the surface of the truck, but it will slide off the truck, right? So it will be given by mu times Fn. Fn is the normal force acting on the object. And if we look at the force free body diagram, we see that Fn is just equal to mg because there is no vertical motion of the block. So the force will be mu, the coefficient of friction, static friction, times mg. And what is the maximum acceleration of the truck before the box starts to slide? So now we set this to maximum frictional force to the force applied by the truck, which is F equals ma, and we see that the acceleration of the truck is given by mu times g. So there will be other problems like this in the tutorials and assignments.